Now, as I said, we are coming to the to a very important Madani surah, and that is Surah An-Nur. Just recall, now we are having in the Mus'haf a Madani surah after 14 Makki surahs. Yunus, Hud, Yusuf, alayhimus salam, Ar-Ra'd, Ibrahim, Al-Hijr, An-Nahl, Bani Israel, Al-Kahf, Maryam, Taha, and Anbiya. And then lastly, Al-Hajj and Al-Mu'minun. We have just finished Al-Mu'minun. Now this is the surah. It comprises 9 sections, and it has, I think, nearly about 70 or 63 perhaps ayat. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Suratun anzalnaha wa faradnaha. This is a very strange beginning of a surah. Mostly we have been seeing either huruf-e-muqatta'at, alif lam mim, alif lam ra, alif lam mim sad, alif lam mim ra, and so on and so forth. Or mention of the glory for Allah, or His praise, or some introduction of Quran, some praise of Quran. Only a few had started absolutely without any preface. We find Surah An-Nisa and Surah Al-Ma'idah, direct address. Ya ayyuhan nas, ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. But here it's very peculiar. Particularly this surah being mentioned and utilized. Suratun, and this common noun in Arabic comes for something which is very big, very high. At-tankeer lit-takhfeem, they call it. This is the rule in the nahf grammar of Arabic. Suratun is a very grand surah, anzalnaha, which we have sent down. Wafaradnaha, and we have enjoined upon you, prescribed upon you. You have to abide by it. Ayatun faradna anzalna fiha ayatin bayyanatin la'allakum tadhakkaroon. And we have sent down in it very clear signs and revelations so that you get the admonition. Number one, straight off, az-zaniyatu waz-zani, the adulteress and the adulterer. Fajlidu kulla wahidin minhuma mi'ata jaldah, flog each one of them 100 stripes. Wala ta'khudhukum biha ra'fatun fi dinillah, and let not tenderness for them seize you regarding the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the hadd of Allah. This has been prescribed by Allah. You have to execute. You have to flog them 100 stripes. Maybe you are feeling sympathetic towards them, but it should not come in the way. These commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have to be executed. In kuntum tu'minuna billahi wal yawmil akhir. If you really believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last day, وَلْيَشْهَدْ عَذَابَهُمَا, and their chastisement should be witnessed, طَائِفَةٌ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, by a group of the believers. They should see it with their eyes. When they are being flogged, there should be people to watch and see, so that there is terror. It becomes a deterrent for other people that this is the punishment. If I do the same, it will come to me also. And this is the philosophy of the severe punishments that are prescribed in Islam. A deterrence. And we have examples even today. Wherever these punishments are enforced, crime just evaporates. Formerly there was an example of Saudi Arabia, but now things are different there because there are a lot of immigrants over there. People having coming from all the hooks and corners of the world. But recently, now we find the same thing in Afghanistan. Even Dr. Javed Iqbal, a somewhat secular type of, you know, scholar. But when he visited Afghanistan and we came back, he addressed a meeting in Jamia Haqqaniya, Akura Khatak, and he said, what I have seen in Afghanistan, if this can happen in a few more Muslim countries, then the whole world will accept Islam. Yes, peace, tranquility, no fear of theft, nothing of the sort. All peace. And that is because, you know, the punishments are very severe. If you kill somebody, you will be killed. And you will be killed in the same way in which you have killed. If you are stabbed, well, they are of that person whom you have killed has the right to stab you, just as you stabbed the person whom you killed. الزاني لا ينكح إلا زانية أو مشركة. The adulterer should not marry except an adulteress or someone from among the mushrikeen, some woman from the associates. والزانية لا ينكحها إلا زاني أو مشرك. And the adulteress, she should not be married except by some adulterer or some mushrik, male. وَحُرِّمَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And this has been prohibited for the believers. But please note, this is a divine providence, not a law. If some woman commits adultery, and if she was unmarried, she has had the 100 stripes, then she makes tawbah. You can marry her. There's no bar. It's not law. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, He decides in His own providence that, you know, as we say, birds of the same feather flock together. So Zaniya and Zanis, they will flock together. It is the natural phenomenon. They have an inclination towards each other. And you know, the people who are chaste themselves, they wouldn't like. So this is a general phenomenon, not a law of the Sharia. وَالَّذُونَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَدَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَعْتُوا بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءَ. As for those who accuse chaste women, and then they can't bring forth four witnesses. If you blame that she has or he has committed adultery, but he cannot produce four witnesses, eyewitnesses. فَجْلَدُوهُمْ ثَمَانِينَ جَلْدًا. Flog them 80 stripes. وَلَا تَقْبَلُوا لَهُمْ شَهَادَةً أَبَدًا. And then after that, never accept from them any testimony in any case. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. And definitely they are the transgressors. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَابُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ. Except those who repent after that, وَأَصْلَحُوا, and who have amended, and they have rectified their behavior. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُرُ رَحِيمٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and merciful. وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ أَزْوَاجَهُمْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ شُهَدَاءَ إِلَّا أَنفُسُهُمْ. Now there is a special case. Whosoever accuses his wife, but there is no witness except him, he has seen the wife committing adultery. Now when he has seen this with his own eyes, can he live with her now? So what to do? But he doesn't have four witnesses. What should he do? وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ أَزْوَاجَهُمْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ شُهَدَاءَ. And those who accuse their wives, but they don't have four witnesses. فَشَهَادَةُ أَحَدِهِمْ أَرْبَعُ شَهَدَاتٍ بِاللَّهِ. So their testimony will be equal to four testimonies if they swear by Allah. I swear by Allah, I am true. I am telling you the truth. This is the truth. إِنَّهُ لَمِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ. That I am true, truthful. وَالْخَامِسَةُ. An additional fifth, you know, there should be أَنَّ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ إِنْ كَانَ مِنَ الْكَاذِبِينَ. That if I am a liar, then the curse of Allah should come to me. Now his one testimony now is equal to four testimonies. This will be accepted. But will the woman, the wife, be given the punishment straight off? No. She will also be given a chance. وَيَدْرَعُ عَنْهَا الْعَذَابَ أَنْ تَشْهَدَ أَرْبَعَ شَهَادَاتٍ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَمِنَ الْكَاذِبِينَ. But you know, the punishment would be removed from her if she also swears four times by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that my husband is telling a lie, he is a liar. وَالْخَامِسَةَ, and for the fifth time she should say, أَنَّ غَضَبَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا إِنْ كَانَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ, that the wrath of Allah should come to me if he is truthful. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this law to you, how to settle such affairs. And he is giving them to you in detail. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابٌ حَكِيمٌ, and verily Allah is the acceptor of repenting, and he is the wise. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ جَعَوْا بِالْإِفْكِ, now there is coming a historical event. It so happened after, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the believers were coming back from the battle of Mustalaq, Bani al-Mustalaq. And there was a camp at night somewhere. Hazrat Aisha, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiyallahu ta'ala, was with him on this journey on a separate camel. So she had some need to urinate, perhaps. So she went away from the camp. But till such time that she came back, when she came back, she found there was a necklace and it is lost. It has dropped from somewhere. She went again. And when she came back now the caravan had gone, left. She was left alone over there. But she made a very wise decision. I should not move from here. She stayed there and then, waiting for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now decides for her. There was a duty of Safwan ibn Mu'attal radiallahu anhu. He used to walk a little distance behind the caravan, main caravan, to see whether something is dropped, someone has left something, or maybe someone is sick and is not able to walk, and he's just lying down, he needs help. When he saw, you know, someone lying there, and Hazrat Aisha had gone to sleep, and her face was now uncovered. When he came, he recognized, oh, she is Aisha, the wife of Nabi, wife of the Prophet. The words came out, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And Hazrat Aisha specifies in this hadith that Safwan recognized me because he had seen me before the commandment of hijab. The commandment of hijab, covering the faces and covering the body for women, it had come in Surah Al-Ahzab. And Surah Al-Ahzab was revealed in the fifth year after Hijra. And this incident is happening in the sixth year after Hijra. So because he had seen me before the coming down of those commandments regarding hijab, so he recognized me. But what he did, he just made his camel sit. So Hazrat Aisha mounted the camel, and then, you know, he held the rope and went towards the main caravan, main army, and met there. But Abdullah ibn Ubay, the chief of the Munafiqeen, he saw Safwan ibn Mu'attal is coming with the wife of the Prophet Aisha radiallahu ta'ala. Now he started a slander. There must have been some wrong thing. How is it possible? A male and a female alone, and they don't commit anything. Impossible. So she had not come safe. And with this started a very big campaign of slander against Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. About 1 month passed, which was very painful for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the incident which is mentioned here. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ جَعَوْا بِالْإِفْكِ عُصْبَةٌ مِنْكُمْ, verily those who have brought forth this slander, they are a group from your among yourselves. They are Muslims. Even Abdullah ibn Ubay was also a legal Muslim. But in this thing, you know, so many mu'mineen sadiqeen, true Muslims, were also involved there. It's the weakness of human nature. You just accept something bad as if you are already, you are ready to accept whatever is coming from some other man's mouth. لا تحسبوه شر لكم, don't think شر لكم that it is evil for you, بل هو خير لكم, this is good for you, because this will become the reason why these commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are being revealed to you for the future guidance. لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَكْتَسَبَ مِنَ الْإِسْمِ, for each one of them there will be the reward or punishment for much, whatever he earned. وَالَّذِي تَوَلَّا كِبْرَهُ, and the one among them who took the bulk of it, greatest share, that was Abdullah ibn Ubay, who was the initiator. لَهُ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ, for him is a very mighty chastisement. لَوْلَا سَمِعْتُمُوهُ, why did it not happen that when you listen to it, ظَنَّ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بِأَنفُسِهِمْ خَيْرًا, the believing men and believing women should have thought well about themselves. Who was Aisha? Aisha was the wife of the Prophet. They should have said, وَقَالُوا هَذَا إِفْكٌ مُبِينٌ, it is definitely a slander. لَوْلَا جَاؤُوا عَلَيْهِ بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءَ, why didn't they bring four witnesses on this? فَإِذَمْ يَعْتُوا بِالشُّهَدَاءَ, so when they couldn't bring witnesses, فَأُولَٰئِكَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ هُمُ الْكَاذِبُونَ, so Allah holds them to be the liars. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ, and if there was not the bounty of Allah on you and His mercy, فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, in this world also and in the hereafter also, لَمَسَّكْنُ فِي مَا أَفَسْتُمْ فِيهَ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ, then whatever you have indulged in, it would have given you a very mighty chastisement. اِسْتَلَقَّوْنَهُ بِأَلْسِنَتِكُمْ, when you were propagating it by your tongues, وَتَقُولُنَا بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ مَا لَيْسَ لَكُمْ بِهِ عِلْمٌ, and you were saying with your mouths, for what you had no knowledge, it was mere hearsay. You listen and then you tell anybody else also, without making sure that this is correct. That is why the Prophet had said, كَفَى بِالْمَرِ كَذِبًا أَنْ يُحَدِّثَ بِكُلِّ مَا سَمِعَ, it is sufficient for a man to be declared a liar if he says whatever he listens. Whatever he listens, he should first assess whether it is correct or wrong. If it is correct, then he can do it. He can spread it further. But if it is wrong, and he is spreading, he has become an agent in the spreading of the falsehood. اِسْتَلَقَّوْنَهُ بِأَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَتَقُولُنَا بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ مَا لَيْسَ لَكُمْ بِهِ عِلْمٌ وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا, and you are thinking it's a trivial matter. وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ, in the sight of Allah, it is a mighty thing. وَلَوْلَا سَمِعْتُمُوهُ قُلْتُمْ, why didn't it happen that when you listen to it, you should have said, مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا, it doesn't behove us that we should speak about this thing. سُبْحَانَكَ هَذَا بُهْتَانُ رَسِيمٌ, glorified be Allah, this is definitely a mighty lie. يَعِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَنْ تَعُودُوا لِمِسْلِهِ أَبَدًا, Allah exhorts you not to repeat it again forever. إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ, if you are believers. فَيُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making for you His revelations clear. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ, and He is the knower, the wise. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةُ فِي الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, verily those people who wish and love that indecency or its false news should spread among the Muslims, among the believers, لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, for them there will be painful chastisement in this world as well as in the hereafter. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, verily Allah knows and you don't know. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ, and was it not that the bounty and mercy of Allah is upon you, and that Allah is gracious and merciful, you would have been lost. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ, O you who believe, don't follow the footsteps of Satan. وَمَنْ يَتَّبِعْ خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَإِنَّهُ يَأْمُرُ بِالْفَحْشَاءِ. Whosoever follows the footsteps of Satan, well, he is surely, he will instigate everybody to indecent things, وَالْمُنْكَرِ and abominations. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ, and if there was the bounty of Allah and His mercy over you, مَا زَكَى مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ عَبَدًا, none of you would have been able to purify his souls. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءَ, but Allah purifies the souls of those whom He wish. وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ, and Allah is the hearer, the knower. وَلَا يَعْقَلِ أُولُو الْأَفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ أَنْ يُوتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Now there was another incident. Unless you know that, this ayah will not be understood. There was a distant relative of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Mistah. He was also involved in this scandal. In this scandal and slander. So Hazrat Abu Bakr, he swore by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He used to help him monetarily. But when he came to know that he is also included among those people who are slandering, so he swore by Allah, now I'm not going to help you. Now Allah is saying to him, don't do this. وَلَا يَأْتَلِ الْأُولُ الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ, those who possess bounty and abundance among you, let them not swear أَنْ يُوتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى, that they will do good to their relatives or the needy or the muhajireen, those who have migrated in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mistah was also a muhajir. وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا, they should forgive and they should overlook. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ, don't you like that Allah should forgive you? On this Abu Bakr cried out, نُحِبُّ أَنْ تَغْفِرَ لَنَا رَبَّنَا, and he said, okay, I will give the kafara of this swear that I had made, and I will continue my help to Mistah. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ, and Allah is merciful and forgiving. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ الْغَافِلَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ, verily those who accuse chaste women who have never even thought of any wicked thing from among the believing women, لُعِنِي فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, they are cursed in this world also and in the hereafter. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ, for them is a very big chastisement. يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ وَأَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ, on the day when their tongues and their hands and their feet will testify against them as to what they were used to do. يَوْمَئِذٍ يُوَفِّيهِمُ اللَّهُ دِينَهُمُ الْحَقِّ, on that day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them their reward, that is the punishment in full. وَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقُّ الْمُبِينُ, and they will come to know that verily Allah is the truth, total truth, and it is absolutely manifest truth. Again, that, you know, ayah which I said is divine providence. Allah makes these arrangements. Al-khabisatu lil-khabisin, the wicked women are for the wicked men. Al-khabisuna lil-khabisat, and wicked men are for the wicked women. وَالطَّيِّبَاتُ لِلطَّيِّبِينَ, and good women, they are for good people, good men. وَالطَّيِّبُونَ لِلطَّيِّبَاتُ, and good men are for the good women. أُولَٰئِكَ مُبَرَّؤُونَ مِمَّا يَقُولُونَ, they are absolutely innocent and not guilty of what they are saying. لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ, for them is the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a very generous provision. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَدْخُلُوا بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ, now there are some social teachings regarding especially the privacy of a family. So there are certain rules. If you go to visit each other. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la tadkhulu buyutan ghayra buyutikum. O you who believe, don't enter the houses which are not yours. Hatta tastanisu. Until you ask the permission and you greet them with salam. Wa tusallimu ala ahliha. Zalikum khairul lakum la'allakum tadhakkarun. This is better for you if you can get the admonition. Fa illam tajidu fiha ahadan. And if you don't find in it anybody, فَلَا تَدْخُلُوهَا, don't enter it. Then you know there's some blame could come, that there was this and this in this house and this has been stolen, don't enter. حَتَّى يُوزَنَ لَكُمْ. But if the permission is given by the person owning that house, okay, you can enter that house. So, you can enter. وَإِنْ قِيلَ لَكُمْ رَجِعُوا فَرْجِعُوا. And if it is said to you, go back, then go back. Now this is very important. It's a different thing that you come after taking an appointment. In that case, you must be received and entertained. But if you go and suddenly call on somebody without having any appointment, prior appointment, then it's not your right that he must receive you and he must entertain you. Maybe he is busy in something and that business for him is more important than entertaining you. So clear instructions. If it is said to them, return, return, go back. Who asked alakum? That is more pure for you. Wallahu bima ta'amaluna alim. And whatever you are doing, Allah knows it. Laysa alaykum junahun an tadkhulu buyutan ghayra maskunatin. There is no harm upon you, no blame upon you, if you enter the house uninhabited. غَيْرَ مَسْكُونَةٍ فِيهَا مَتَعُونَ لَكُمْ. There is some luggage which belongs to you, property in it. There are stores that nobody inhabits over there. Well, you can enter. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ مَا تُبْدُونَ وَمَا تُكْتُمُونَ. And Allah very well knows what you reveal and what you conceal. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Ask the believers, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they should lower their gaze. Now there are two sets of instructions regarding this hijab and parda and veil and satr, what part of the body has to be covered, etc., etc. The first set was revealed in Surah Ahzab, one year earlier. And there Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given the instructions that if a mu'mina, a believer, believing woman, has to go out, what she should do. Now this is another step forward. Even in your homes, what are the etiquettes that have to be observed? Don't gaze on each other. Even the brothers and sisters shouldn't gaze. Your sister is also a woman, a girl. So don't gaze her. You keep your sight low. قُلِّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُلُّ مِنْ أَفْسَارِهِمْ. They should lower their gaze, وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. And they should guard their sexual organs. ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ. This is surely more pure for them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا يَصْنَعُونَ. Verily Allah knows what you are doing. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. Now the detailed instruction is coming for the women. And say to the believing women also, يَغْضُنَّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. They should also keep their gaze low. وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ. They should also guard their private parts. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ. And they should not reveal or display their adornment, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, except what is apparent thereof. وَلِيَدْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. And let them draw their scars over their bosoms. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ. And they should not expose their adornment and beauty. And now there's the list. Who are, you know, exempted from this? Number one, إِلَّا لِبْعُولَتَهِنَّ. Except for, number one, their husbands. أَوْ آبَائِهِنَّ. Number two, their fathers. Father, grandfather, and so on. وَأَوْ آبَائِ بْعُولَتَهِنَّ. Or the fathers of their husbands, father-in-law, and then the grandfather-in-law, or abnaihinna, or their sons, or abnai ba'ulatihinna, or the sons of their husbands. Maybe there are sons from some former wife, they are also exempt. Or ikhwanihinna, or their own brothers, or bani ikhwanihinna, and the sons of their brothers. أو بني أخواتهن or the sons of their sisters أو نسائهن or their own women Muslim women not strangers أو ما ملكت أيمانهن or the female slaves whom their right hands possess أو التابعين غير أولي الأربعة or the attendants and servants who don't have any sexual desire من الرجال from among the men, أَوِ الطِّفْلِ الَّذِي لَمْ يَظَرُوا عَلَىٰ عَوْرَاتِ النِّسَاءِ or the child who is not up till now acquainted with the secret matters of women. وَلَا يَظْلِمْنَا بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ they shouldn't strike their feet on the earth. لَيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ so that their ornaments that they are wearing, they give voice and you know, attention of the people goes towards this. بَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا And you should repent towards Allah, all of you. أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ O you, the believers, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ So that they should, you should prosper and you should be successful. And wed the spouseless among you. If there is a woman, she has become widow, try to get her married again as soon as possible. In the same way, widower, a person without any wife, a young man, he is young, full, and you know, he has the sexual desire, so you should make him marry as soon as possible. وَأَنْكَهُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَصْوَالِهِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ And also, the righteous ones from among their slaves, males or females, إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَىٰ If they are poor, يغنيهم الله من فضله Allah will make them rich from His bounty. والله واسع عليم and Allah is ample giving and knower. وليستعفف الذين لا يجدون نكاحا As for those women who are past the age of marriage or past the age of bearing children. So these rules are somewhat, you know, loosened for them. وليستعفف الذين لا يجدون نكاحا And let those, no, this is another subject. And let those who find not the means to marry keep chaste. If someone is poor, he can't support wife, he should wait. Hatta yugnihum Allahu min fadli. Till such time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes him able to support a family. Waladina yabtaghuna al-kitaba mimma malakat aymanukum. And from among your slaves who want to get right down for emancipation, that I will pay you 10,000 dinars. You set me free. Now there is an agreement. Now he's working hard. He's doing labor, gathering money. There is also advice to the Muslims. You should also contribute so that it becomes easy for him to get the freedom. So if he wants that he should, mukatabah, this is called, that an agreement of emancipation should be concluded. فَكَاتِبُوهُمْ إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا If you have seen in them good, that they are gentlemen, then you must enter into such agreement with them. وَآتُوهُمْ مِمَا اللَّهِ الَّذِي آتَاكُمْ And also give them from the wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. وَلَا تُكْرِهُ فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَنَ الْبِغَاءِ And don't compel your slave girls to prostitution. إِنْ أَرَدْنَا تَحَسُّنًا If they want to lead a chaste life, لَتَبْتَهُ أَرْضَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا You want to get some worldly rewards for that, some worldly wealth. وَمَنْ يُكْرِهُنَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِكْرَاهِنَّ غُفُرُ الرَّحِيمِ Whosoever compels them, then surely Allah is after their compulsion, forgiving and merciful. Allah will not hold that girl, slave girl, as a culprit, because she has been forced to do it by her master. وَلَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ آيَاتٍ مُبَيِّنَاتٍ and we have sent down to you إِلَيْكُمْ آيَاتٍ مُبَيِّنَاتٍ very clear illuminating revelations وَمَثَلًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِن قَبْلِكُمْ and we have given you the descriptions of those people who were before you وَمَوْعِظَةً لِلْمُتَّقِينَ and the exhortation for those who are God-fearing. Allahu Nuru Samawati Wal-Ard. Now, the most important ayah of this surah. Rather, one of the most important ayat of the whole of Quran. A simile for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Nuru Samawati Wal-Ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. What does it mean? Just as we need light to see each other, to see this world, we can't see. You might have, the sight is here, it's okay. But you can't see without light. In the same way, the hidden realities of this universe, which we call metaphysical realities of this world, they cannot be understood except you know Allah first. You believe Him first, then only you will be able to know all the hidden and metaphysical realities of this universe and existence. Allahu Nuru Samawati Wal Ard. Masalu Nurihi. The similitude of His light is this. Kamishkatin fiha misbah. There is a niche in the wall and there is a lamp in the niche. Al-misbahu fi zujajah. And the lamp is in a glass. Az-zujajatu ka'annaha kawkabun durriyun. And that glass appears as if it was a shining star. Yuqatu min shajaratin. And this lamp, you know, is burnt, lighted, from the oil of a shajaratin mubarakatin, a very blessed tree. And that is the tree of zaytun, olive. La sharqiyatin wa la gharbiyah. Which belongs to neither the eastern part nor the western part. Now this, you know, olive tree, which is standing alone, full day, the heat of sun and rays of sun are playing on it. If some tree is towards the east of some big wood collection of trees, then in the morning it will get the rays of the sun, but not in the evening. It will be under the shadow. If it is towards the west, then in the morning it will not be able to get the sunshine and the solar energy it will not be able to absorb, but it will be only available in the evening. But a solitary tree standing alone, it has all the day absorbed the solar energy in it. لا شرقيه ولا غربيه يكاد زيتها يضيء. Now the oil of such a tree is so clear, so clear. يكاد زيتها يضيء, that it is ready to glow. لو لم تمسسه نار, although fire had not touched it. Now we can understand this, the difference. We had kerosene oil or mustard oil. In lamps we used to use them, but they don't catch fire themselves. You have to have some cotton root weed, put it here, then through that cotton weed it will burn and then you will get the light. But what about petrol? It is as if it catches fire, although you have not brought the fire to it, it itself advances forward and catches fire. So this is the simile which is being used here. There are certain people, the oil of their nature is so nascent, so pure, that they are as if awaiting for the call of the Prophet of Allah to respond to it immediately. We read the ayah in Surah Al Imran. رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا سَمِعْنَا مُنَادِيًا يُنَادِي لِلْإِيمَانِ أَنْ آمِنُوا بِرَبِّكُمْ فَآمَنَّا. And we have the example of Abu Bakr Siddiq, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to anyone, to all to whom I presented my da'wah, they took some time to understand, except Abu Bakr. He didn't wait even for a second. Why? You know, the oil of his nature, which was burning already in his heart. Now you know, this our chest, the ribs, they are just like the niche in the wall. Then there's the heart. It's like a lamp placed in that niche. And you know, it is shining. But this shining, this nur is not like this nur. This is the internal light of the faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nurun ala nur. When the fire touches it, now it is nur over nur, light over light. One was the light of the pure nature within the man, other in the light of the revelation. When they join together, well, this is Iman, 100% Iman, the strongest Iman. Nurun ala nur. Yadillahu li nurihi man yasha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides to his light whomsoever he wishes. وَيَذْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ. And Allah strikes these similitudes for the people. وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. This is the necessity for the human beings. They can't grasp these subtle realities. So they need some similitudes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he strikes the similitudes for the people. Whereas he knows everything as it is. Just as there was a prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma arini haqiqat al-ashya'i kama hiya. Oh Allah, show me the reality of things as they are really, not as they appear. The apparent is visible to the animals also. The dog has also seen that the car is coming and it is saving itself. If you have also seen so, what's the difference? But that inner light, seeing by the heart, hearing by the heart, pondering over through heart, through your ruh, that is something else. Fi buyutin, now this light in the persons, where will you find it? Where to find it? The most important place are the houses of Allah. Because they love the houses of Allah. They want to spend maximum time in the houses of Allah. Fi buyutin azin Allahu an turfa'a wa yuskara fi asmuhu. In those houses about whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded that it should be raised and his name should be remembered over there. Bil ghudubi wal asal. In the mornings and in the evenings. Rijalun la tulhihim tijaratun wala bay'un. They are those men whom neither the trade nor any particular bargain stops from the remembrance of Allah and establishing the prayer. Now first, for example, let us suppose a shopkeeper was sitting from the morning. No customer came. And when a customer enters the shop, there is the call for azan also. Now he is being tested. If he attends to the customer, that means he has attached more importance to this worldly gain. رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَعْيَوْنَ. Those men who cannot be prevented by any trading or any particular bargain from the remembrance of Allah and glorifying Him and establishing Salah and giving the obligatory zakah. يَخَافُونَ يَوْمًا. Even after doing all this, they keep fearing, they keep trembling about that day, تَتَقَلَّبُ فِيهِ الْقُلُوبَ وَالْأَبْصَارِ, in which the sights and the hearts will be overturned. إِنَّ زَلْزَلَةَ السَّاعَةِ شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ. We have already read. So they tremble at the thought of that day. أَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. لِيَجْزِيَهُمُ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنَ مَا عَمِلُوا. So that Allah should reward them, recompense them with the best of what they did. وَيَزِيدَهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. And He should add to the reward from His bounty. The reward is to be calculated according to their deeds. But from His bounty He can give anything, as much as He likes. There's no need of reckoning or any arithmetic or mathematics. وَاللَّهُ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives and provides whosoever He will without any reckoning. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala include us among those. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ كَسَرَابٍ بِقِيعَةٍ يَحْسَبُهُ الظَّمْآنُ مَاءً حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَهُ لَمْ يَجِدْهُ شَيْئًا وَوَجَدَ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ فَوَفَّاهُ حِسَابَهُ واللہ سریع الحساب او کظلمات فی بحر اللجی یخشاہ موج من فوقہ موج من فوقہ سحاب ظلمات بعضها فوق بعض اذا اخرج یده لم یکد یراها ومن لم یجعل اللہ له نورا فما له من نور صدق اللہ العظیم. This fifth section of Surah An-Nur is the central also, because it has nine sections, four before this, four after this. It occupies the central position. Subject is also very important. In four ayat, a simile for Iman. How is Iman created in the hearts of the people? Two lights joined together. One light is of the nature within the human beings, the ruh that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought it to him. The other light is Quran, which is coming outside. When they join together, Nurun ala Nur. Now this is light upon light. This is Iman. Then how and where will you find them? We have been given a picture of their character, their, what are, you know, their priorities, what they like, what they are busy in. So we have all this. But now, two shades of kufr. One kufr is plain kufr. Deny there is no Allah, or there is no revelation, no prophethood, no messengerhood, or there is no resurrection, no hereafter. This is plain kufr. The other kufr is that they say, I believe in Him, I believe in Allah, I believe in the messenger of Allah, I believe in Quran, but they are acting to the contrary. They don't have the real Iman. We call them the munafiqun. So now what do these two shades of kufr, there are similes. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ كَسَرَابٍ بِقِيَاتٍ. As for those who are disbelievers, although they say that we believe, but their deeds, good deeds, they also do some good deeds to satisfy their conscience. Their good deeds are like a mirage in a desert. The thirsty person thinks that he is water. يَحْسَبُهُ الظَّمَانُ مَا حَتَّى إِذَا جَاهُ. When after, you know, maximum toiling, it reaches there, he reaches there, لَمْ يَجِدْهُ شَيَّا. Doesn't find anything over there, no water. وَوَجَدَ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ فَوَفَّاهُ حِسَابًا. And he finds Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala waiting for him there. That is the death. So he gives him the full reckoning of his deeds. وَاللَّهُ سَرِيُّ الْحِسَابِ. And Allah doesn't need much time in reckoning. Now these people who don't have real Iman, and they are doing certain good things. I have established a foundation, I have started an orphanage, I have started a house for the old people, I have started a madrasa, and so on and so forth. But if they don't have real Iman, these good deeds, they will be hoping that on the day of judgment, they will have some weight in the scales of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they will be weightless in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These good deeds for them will be like a mirage. They will be hoping that they will meet these good deeds in the hereafter, but they will find nothing over there. Now the second shade, total kufr, absolute kufr. Not even, you know, by word or by mouth, accepting Allah or His command. So this is like kazulumatin, aw kazulumatin fi bahril lujjiyin. Or like the darknesses in the deep sea, there covers a mighty wave, and above that mighty wave, another mighty wave, min fawqihi sahab. And above these waves, there are the clouds. Now these are darknesses upon darknesses. In the depth of the ocean, darkness. But at night, when there are clouds also, no reflection of the stars even, no reflection of the moon even. Absolute darkness. So this is the simile. And there is an incident that an admiral, French admiral, he accepted Islam on this simile. He researched whether Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been having the ocean, the journey in oceans, whether he had the experience. When he was told that he came to know, he never traveled by sea. He had no experience. He said that this simile cannot be given except by a person who has, you know, all the life held him in the oceans. But if he was not in the ocean, then this simile is coming from Allah and nothing else, none else. اذا اخرج يده ضربات بعضها فوق بعض. There are layers of darknesses over darknesses. اذا اخرج يده لم يكن يراها. When he extends his own arm, he cannot see it. Although he has the sense of direction, that this is my arm, I have extended it in this direction, but can't see it. اذا اخرج يده لم يكن يراها. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not granted light, he cannot have any light from any other source. أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Don't you see that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all those who are heavens and in the earth, they are glorifying him. Or not only amen, but تَيْرُ صَافَّاتِ, also the birds, with their outspread wings. كُلٌّ قَدْ عَلِمَ صَلَاتَهُ وَتَسْبِيحَهُ. We had this mazmoon. This thing came before also in Surah Bani Israel. وَإِمْ مِنْ شَيْنْ إِلَّا يُصَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُ. There is not a single thing in the whole of the universe which is not glorifying Allah with His praise. But you can't understand. كُلٌّ قَدْ عَلِمَ صَلَاتَهُ وَتَسْبِيحَهُ. Every creator has known its prayer and its glory, glorification of Allah. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا يَفْعَلُونَ. Allah knows what they are doing. وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. To Allah belongs the sovereignty of the heavens and the earth. وَإِلَلَّهِ الْمَصِيرُ. And to Him, to Allah, is the return. أَلَمْ تَرَى أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُزْجِي صَحَابًا. Don't you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drives the clouds. ثُمَّ يُؤَلِّفُ بَيْنَهُمْ. Then gathers them together. ثُمَّ يَجْعَلُهُ رُكَامًا. Then makes them a mass. فَتَرَى الْوَدْقَ يَخْرُجُ مِنْ خِلَالِهِ. And then you see that the rain is coming down in between these clouds. وَيُنَزْلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مِنْ جِبَالٍ فِيهَا مِنْ بَرَدٍ. And from the heaven he also sends down the hail, hailstorm, as if there is some mountain of hail in the air, and from there these hails are coming. فَيُسِيبُ بِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He strikes with these hails the field of those whom he wishes to destroy the crops. وَيَصْرِفُ عَمَّنْ يَشَاءُ. And he turns them away from the fields of those people whom Allah likes. They are saved. Their you know, harvests are saved. يَكْعَادُ سَنَا بَرْقِهِ. The flashing of his lightning is near. يَزْهَبُ بِالْأَبْصَارِ. Is near that it will snatch away the sight of the people. يُقَلِّبُ اللَّهُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns the night and the day. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. In this there is a lesson for those who have real eyes, real sight, they see. وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَ كُلَّ دَابَّةٍ مِّن مَّاءٍ. And Allah has created all the moving creatures on this earth from water. The source of life, I have told you, is water. Source of our creation is the clay. Water and clay joined together to make mud. And from the mud, you know, then the life started. وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَ كُلَّ دَابَّةٍ مِّن مَّاءٍ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَمْشِي عَلَى بَطْنِهِ. Now from among them there are those also who go upon their bellies, the snakes, etc., etc., the reptiles. They are moving on their bellies. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَمْشِي عَلَى رِجْلَيْنِ. And among them are those who move on two legs. Man, for example, and chimpanzee, and so on and so forth. So many things. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَمْشِي عَلَى أَرْبَعْ. There are those who move on four legs. يَخْلُقُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ. Allah creates whatever He likes. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Verily Allah is powerful on everything. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا آيَاتٍ بَيِّنَاتٍ مُبَيِّنَاتٍ. O people, we have certainly sent down these ayat, which are very illuminating. وَاللَّهُ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. And Allah guides to whomsoever He wishes, إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ, towards the straight path. Now there is an address to the munafiqun. You know, one of the common subjects discussed in the Madani surahs, there is the subject of nifaq and munafiqun. So although a very brief reference, but there is a reference. وَيَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالرَّسُولِ. And there are people who say, we believe in Allah and His Messenger, وَاتَعْنَا. and we believe and we obey. ثم يتولى فريق منهم من بعد ذلك. Then some of them turn their faces away. وما أولئك بالمؤمنين, and they are not really believing people. وإذا دعوا إلى الله ورسوله ليحكم بينهم, when they are called towards Allah and His Messenger, so that Allah, the Messenger of Allah, should decide matters between them, judge between them, إذا فريق منهم يعرضون, a group of them turns away. They don't come to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to get their disputes settled. وَإِن يَكُمْ لَهُمُ الْحَقُّ يَعْتُوا إِلَيْهِ مُزْعِنِينَ. But if the right is on their side, then they will come, you know, and they will come believing and submissively. أَفِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ. Is there a disease in their hearts? أَبِرْتَابُ. Or they have doubts? أَمْ يَخَافُونَ يَحِيفَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَرَسُولُهُ. Or do they fear that Allah and the Messenger will deal unjustly with them? بَلْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Nothing of these things, but actually they are the evil doers. إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Now, the saying of the believers, when they are called toward Allah and His Messenger, is لَيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُ, so that the Messenger should decide matters and disputes between them. أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. That they say, we listen and we obey. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And only those are actually successful. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَخْشَى اللَّهَ وَيَتَّقْهِ. And whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, and then he is fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and has regard for Him, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَائِزُونَ. Only such people will be successful. وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ. Now, as you know, one of the weakness of the munafiqeen was that they didn't want to go to fight in the way of Allah, risking their lives. But whenever this matter was discussed, they said, وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ. And they swore by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the full emphasis at their command, لَإِنْ أَمَرْتَهُمْ لَا يَخْرُجُنْ. If you command us, oh, Messenger of Allah, we shall definitely go out. But you know, this is my excuse. This is, you know, where I am tied up. So, if you give me permission, I will be very much thankful. But if you say you must go, I shall go. قُلْ لَا تُقْسِمُوا. Tell them, don't swear. تَعْتُمْ مَعْرُوفَةً. There should be reasonable obedience. إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Verily, Allah is aware of what you are doing. قُلْ أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ. Now here, in contrast to the attitude of the munafiqeen, the attitude of mu'mineen, really believing Muslims, that is also given. قُلْ أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ. O mu'mins, O Muslims, O Muhammad, say to them, obey Allah and obey His Rasul, His Messenger. فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا. But if they turn their faces, فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْهِ مَا حُمِّلَ وَعَلَيْكُمْ مَا حُمِّلْتُمْ. On our Messenger is the responsibility of what has been loaded on his shoulder. The duty is to convey to you the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is responsible only to that extent. But on your shoulder is the duty which has been placed on your shoulders. You will be responsible. Did you believe in those revelations? And then did you act upon them? فَعَلَيْهِ مَا حُمِّلَ وَعَلَيْكُمْ مَا حُمِّلْتُمْ. And this is very important, you know, in Islamic organizations. This should be kept before every person who is working. Sometimes they have complaints about their Amir. He is not handling the matters correctly. Okay, if he is committing mistake, he will have to answer on the day of judgment. But you go on obeying it till such time that he commands something which is haram, which is forbidden. Then you say, La sama wa la ta'a. We are not going to listen nor obey. But till such time that the Amir is ordering and commanding something which is within the limits of the Sharia, you can't say we are not going to obey. You have to obey. And if something wrong is done by the Amir, then he will be responsible on the day of judgment. Maybe you get some of his good deeds on the day of judgment. وَإِن تُطِيعُوهُ تَهْتَدُوا. And if you obey him, then you will be guided to the right path. وَمَا عَلَى الرَّسُولِ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ. And on our Messenger is no responsibility except of conveying the message of Allah in a very clear way. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Now this is also one of the most important ayat of Quran. This is ayatul istikhlaf. The promise that Allah gave to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they will be given power and authority and rule in this earth, in this land. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Allah has promised those among you who fulfill two conditions. They have real iman and they do real good deeds. لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. They will make them the successors in authority and rule in the land, in the earth. كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. Just as he had made the caliphs before them. There was Dawood. يَا دَاوُدُ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاكَ خَلِيفَةً فِي الْأَرْضِ. There was Suleiman. There was the Maccabi Empire. What were they? They were the caliphs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same way, Allah will give you caliphate. وَيُوَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي تَظَاهَ لَهُمْ. And the second promise, actually there are three promises, but they are one in three. The same thing repeated for the purpose of emphasis. He will establish the deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has approved for them. Islam will be supreme. وَلَيُبَدَّلَنَّهُمْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا. Three, this fear case, this condition of fear, lest you know some enemy is coming and attacking from the north. Maybe the Quraysh are coming from the south. Maybe the other tribes are coming from Najd, etc., etc. There was always a state of emergency in Medina. Always a fear that somebody, some tribe might attack. But you know, then you know the condition of fear will be changed into security and peace. وَلَا يُبَدَّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا. يَعْبُدُونَنِي. Then they will obey me fully. Why? Till such time that the deen of Allah is not supreme. Your obedience to Allah is partial. In America, can you obey Allah and His deen completely? No. You are bound by the laws here. Even the family laws. You have to abide by them. You can do as you like. And then, all over the world, can you be free from riba, from interest? Till such time that the whole system of the deen of Allah is established, our obedience to Allah is partial. Somewhere it is 12%, 15%, 20%. Nowhere on the earth there is 100% total obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then, you are not obeying Allah in totality. So for there you have to work. And when the deen of Allah is established, when they are in the system of caliphate, then actually the whole deen will be enforced. And then people will be able to obey Allah in totality. لا يشركون بي شيئا. And they will not associate with me anybody, anything. وَمَنْ كَفَرَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. And whosoever disbelieves even after this, we have made these three promises with such an emphasis. لَيُمَكِّنَنَّهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي تَظَاهَ لَهُمْ وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Such emphatic promises. Even then, if you don't gird up your loins and struggle for it, then it means you are fasiq. Then they are the transgressors. وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ. And establish the prayer and pay zakah. وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ. Obey Rasul. The Rasul at that time was not only a messenger of Allah. He was also the leader of the community. He was the ruler at Medina. He was the commander-in-chief of the army. Who led the army at Badr? Who led the army at Uhud? Who led the army at Ahzab? So his obedience has to be total. وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. So that Allah's mercy is shown to you. لَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مَوْجَدِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Don't think that these people, disbelievers, can defeat Allah in the land. وَمَا بَاهُمُ النَّارِ. And their abode is fire. وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرِ. It's a very bad and evil destination. يا أيها الذين آمنوا ليستأذنكم الذين ملكت أيمانكم والذين لم يبلغوا الحلم منكم ثلاث مرات. Now these are again, you know, instructions regarding the privacy at the homes. For you who believe, those of you, your slaves, and also the children who have not reached puberty, they also should seek permission to come to you, to enter your privacy at three times. Now three times are, as a rule you may say, you know, the sexual intercourse between the husband and the wife, in one of these three times. من قبل صلاة الفجر, before the dawn prayer, وَهِنَا تَدَعُونَ سِيَابَكُمْ مِنَ الظَّهِيرَةِ, and when you cast away your over garments, you know, outer garments, and at the noon, وَمِنْ بَعْدِ صَلَاةِ الْإِشَاءِ, and after the prayer of night prayer, Isha. سَلَاسُ عَرَاتُكُمْ, these three times are of privacy for you. لَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَا عَلَيْهِمْ جُنَاهُمْ بَعْدَهُنَّ, after these times, you know, there's no blame. The servants and, you know, the bondsmen, the slaves and the children, they can come to you. تَوَّافُونَ عَلَيْكُمْ بَعْدُكُمْ بَعْبَاسُ, you keep coming to each other. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. In this way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains and makes clear His ayat, His revelation, and Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. وَإِذَا بَلَغَ الْأَطْفَالُ مِنْكُمُ الْحُلُمُ, when the children reach the age of puberty, فَلْيَسْتَعْذُنُوا كَمَا اسْتَعْذَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, then they should also ask permission to enter into that private room where the parents are. They should straight off enter that room. كَمَا اسْتَعْذَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, as the command was given to those who were before mentioned. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ عَيَاتِهِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. And in this way Allah is making clear to you His revelations. And Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. وَالْقَوَائِدُ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ اللَّاتِي لَا يَرْجُونَ نِكَاحًا, this is the case which I thought was discussed at that time. When a woman reaches a stage, she's past the age of marriage, past the age of bearing children. Now these precautions are not absolutely necessary for them. For young women, you know, who can enter into an agreement of marriage, who are able to bear children, their case is different. وَالْقَوَائِدُ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ اللَّاتِي لَا يَرْجُونَ نِكَاحًا, as for the past child-bearing women who hope not to get married, فَلَا جُنَاهَ عَلَيْهِنَّ أَنْ يَضَعْنَ ثِيَابَهُنَّ, there's no blame on them if they put off their outer garments. غَيْرَ مُتَبَرِّجَاتٍ بِزِينَةٍ, but they also should see that they don't use this as an excuse in displaying their adornment. وَإِنْ يَسْتَعْفِفْنَ خَيْرٌ لَهُنَّ, and if they don't avail of this concession, it is better for them. وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ, and Allah is the all-listening and all-knowing. لَيْسَ عَلَى الْعَمَى حَرَجٌ, there is no blame on the blind. وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْرَجِ حَرَجٌ, nor any blame on the lame. وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيزِ, nor there is any blame on the sick. Harajun, there is no blame on them. Wala ala anfusikum, and not even on you. Antakulu min buyutikum, that you eat from your own houses. Or buyut abaikum, or from the houses of your fathers. Or buyut ummahatikum, or the houses of your mothers. Maybe your mother, your father had died, now she has married another person. She is the wife of some other person, but still, she is your mother. You shouldn't hesitate when you go there and eat something. بَيُوتِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ أَوْ بَيُوتِ أَخْوَانِكُمْ, or the houses of your brothers, أَوْ بَيُوتِ أَخَوَاتِكُمْ, houses of your sisters. Among some tribes in India, Rajputs, they don't want to, you know, take anything and eat anything from the houses of their daughters and sisters. They think it's a shame. We should not eat anything in their houses. But it is not so in Islam. بَيُوتِ أَخَوَاتِكُمْ أَوْ بَيُوتِ أَعْمَامِكُمْ, or the houses of your uncles, أَوْ بَيُوتِ أَمَّاتِكُمْ, or the houses of your aunts, أَوْ بَيُوتِ أَخْوَالِكُمْ, اور دی میٹرنل انکلز اور بطویت خالاتکم اور دی میٹرنل آنٹس اور ما ملکت مفاتحہ اور صدیقکم اور دی ہاؤسز ہوز کیز آر ود یو یو آر دی اتھارٹی سو دیر یو کین گو اینڈ ایٹ اور صدیقکم اینڈ لاسٹ از یور فرینڈ یو کین گو ٹو دی ہاؤسز آف فرینڈ اینڈ ایٹ لیس علیکم جناحن تاکلوا جمیعا واشتاتا دیر از نو بلیم اپون یو اف یو ایٹ ٹوگیدر سٹنگ ٹوگیدر اور سیپریٹلی دیر آر نو بگ ڈرائنگ رومز اینڈ نو ڈائننگ رومز سو ویئر ایور دیر واز اے فیسٹ یو نو وین ایور پیپل کیم اینڈ یو نو اے گروپ کیم اینڈ ٹک دی میل دین وینٹ اوے دین اندر گروپ کیم سو اٹ از اشتاتا بٹ اف کنڈیشن پرمٹ یو کین ہیو اے جوائنٹ فیسٹ فَإِذَا دَخَلْتُمْ بُيُوتًا فَسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ بٹ وین یو اینٹر دا ہاؤسز یو ہیو ٹو سیلوٹ دی پیپل ہو آر دیئر تحیۃً من عند اللہ اٹ شوڈ بی اے گریٹنگ فار ون اندر گریٹنگ فرام اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ دیٹ از السلام علیکم بلیسڈ اینڈ گڈ تحیۃً من عند اللہ مبارکۃً طیبۃً کذلک یبین اللہ لکم آیاتہ لکم الآیات لعلکم تعقلون In this way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making clear to you the revelation so that you may understand. Now, the last three ayat, they are very important, again regarding munafiqeen. What happened to them when there was some expedition? The true mu'mineen were also accompanying Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And munafiqeen had to go also because they wanted they should be listed as mu'mineen. They must be acknowledged as mu'mineen. But then at different times, you know, they kept finding excuses of going back. So this practice of theirs, that is, you know, discussed here. Innamal mu'minun. Verily, the truly believing mu'mins, believers are only those, allatheena amanu billahi wa rasulihi, who have real faith in Allah and His Messenger. Wa idha kanu ama'ahu ala amrin jami'in. And when they are with Him on some collective affair, lam yadhhabu. They don't go back hatta yastazinu before and without getting the permission. If you have to go, go to the Messenger of Allah, Allah, O Messenger of Allah, I have to do this work. It's important for me. Please permit me to go back. But if without asking his permission, without any permission you go, it means you are munafiq. Inna ladina yastazinunaka, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verily, who want to get your permission, أولئك الذين يؤمنون بالله ورسوله they are the people who believe in Allah and His Messenger فإذا استأذنوك لبعض شأنهم so if they want your permission due to some affairs of theirs فاذن لمن شئت منهم so you give permission to whomsoever you wish not that because I have asked the permission it is binding on the Amir to give me the permission no The matter will rest on the Amir. He knows what is the situation, what is, you know, the complexity of the situation. When each and every person, if somebody or somebodies are going back, we get weaker. We need each and every person. So it is the authority of the Amir, whether to permit or not to permit. Fa'azan, then you can give them the permission. Leman shayta minhum. Only to those whom you think fit to be permitted. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمُ اللَّهِ And for them also ask the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? When they have asked the permission, and the permission is given by Muhammad, and now they are going, what's wrong in it? Still, the Prophet has been asked to ask Allah's forgiveness. Why? They have decided that some of their personal matters is more important than the jihad fi sabilillah. Can there be any personal matter more important than the jihad fi sabilillah? If someone places his personal affairs above the jihad, above qital fi sabilillah, no, his values are clear. So they have exhibited a weakness of iman. Well, if your wife is ill, can you give her the help? If she is to die, can you save her if you are there with her? Nothing will happen but for that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. So why you go back? This is the place for jihad and qital. So you do permit them to whomsoever you deem fit, but then ask for forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them. Inna Allaha ghafurur raheem. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghafurur raheem. He is the forgiving and the merciful. La tajalu du'a rasooli baynakum ka du'a ba'dikum ba'za. Don't treat the calling of the messenger among you like the calling of yours for each other. When Rasul is calling you, come. This command is something else. When a friend says to you, come to me please, something else. There is a world of difference between the two. He is the commander-in-chief. He is the ruler. He is the custodian. He is the caliph. Just as Dawood was caliph. Ya Dawood inna jalna ka khalifatan fil ard. Now Muhammad was the caliph sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he entered Medina, till his death, he was the caliph. Then you know, the first caliph in his place was Abu Bakr. But who are the caliph? Who are the ruler at that time? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you don't think that the call of Muhammad is just calling you each other. If you are calling each other. قَدْ يَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ يَتَسَلَّلُونَ مِنْكُمْ لِوَعَذَا. And Allah very well knows those of you who slip away stealthily under some cover. They see, هَلْ يَرَاكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ. These words are there in Surah At-Tawbah. هَلْ يَرَاكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ. All are attentive to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, listening to him. They see that nobody is looking at us, then they slip back, so that they are not noticed. يَتَسَلَّلُونَ مِنْكُمْ لِوَاسَا. They slip away from there, taking some cover. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. So now these people who are working against the matter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his mission, his scheme, his plan, you want to fail them? فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ. That some very big trial may fall upon them. أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Or a very painful chastisement should come to them. أَلَا إِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Behold, to Allah belongs all that is in the heavens and the earth. قَدْ يَعْلَمُ مَا أَنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ. He very well knows what you are and where you stand. How much iman you have in your heart, he knows it. He knows what is your in your heart. مَا فِي صُدُورِكُمْ. يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تُسِرُّونَ وَمَا تُعْلِنُونَ. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. Whatever you have in your chest, Allah knows it. وَيَوْمَ يُرْجَعُونَ إِلَيْهِ. And when they will be returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ. Then he will tell them, بِمَا عَمِلُوا. What deeds they had committed. وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. And Allah is knower of everything.